What I love about manga is its near infinite capacity to astound and enthrall me. It keeps me on the edge of my seat, makes me laugh, makes me cry, and most of all, keeps me engaged in what is most of the time a new reading experience for me. Manga has the ability to take you to new worlds or keep you grounded in the one you're already in. In the case of the Kurosaki Corpse Delivery Service, we treat to a story that covers familiar ground to the seasoned manga reader, and that we're taken to locales widely recognised and overlooked by your everyday person, a university. But as you'll quickly begin to realise from the very first chapter, this manga has the stench of weird looming over every panel of every page of every chapter. And as such, Eiji Otsuka and Hosui Yamazaki, the twisted brilliant individuals who brought this Mephistophelian chronicle of death and unfulfilled wishes to your eyes, will make you rue the day you ever dared to overlook said mundanities. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Archangel, and this is a review of the horror, dark comedy series, The Kurosaki Corpse Delivery Service. Continuing the trend of familiarity, as expected, the story is set in the present day, in a Japanese Buddhist university to be precise. We're introduced to a group of students who upon initial inspection have seemingly absolutely no correlating attributes, socially speaking that is. However, we can certainly assume they're all Buddhists, but what other possible link can these obvious social misfits have? Cue in plot thread, Mr. John Doe. Corpses. The group collectively shares an infatigable urge to study what other normal individuals would shy away from. Rotting cadavers. Something we all inevitably become but generally refuse to face the prospect of. And in what can only be described as perverted irony, these lively undergrads join forces to establish the titular Kurosaki Corpse Delivery Service, a club whereby each member uses their own unique skills and abilities to achieve the recently deceased's final requests. Requests that the undead customers were not able to fulfil before they themselves bit the dust. This allows us, the readers, to engage with the crew as they work from commission to commission, problem solving when they reach a dead end, or trying to retrace the final steps made by the recently acquired customers, and ultimately showcasing this why it's cool to like dead bodies. And what I find hilarious about each episodic chapter or two is how the team try to financially extort each body they come across in the hopes that they can make enough money to sustain themselves, as let's face it, living as a student isn't cheap. So I've explained enough about what goes down and the hilariously morbid hijinks that the Kurosaki crew gets involved in, but how does all of this work? How is it possible to take on dead clientele for financial gain? Well, as previously mentioned, each member holds a unique ability, or grotesque depending on your perspective, that essentially melds the group together and makes the whole operation move in perfect synchronisation. Sometimes. Our lead is Kuro Karatsu, a bald-headed average student who has a whimsical attitude to his beliefs and studies. However, as you'd expect from the protagonist of a series, the Kurosaki crew wouldn't be able to function without him, as he commands the talent of being able to commune with the trapped soul still housed within the bodies, thus essentially being able to start each assignment. Most of the time though, the souls don't actually give the crew a lot to work off of unless it's something very specific that they want or need doing. Next on the roster is our quote-unquote club president, though not as you'd imagine, the tech whiz Ao Sasaki. Emotionally distant, beautiful, and the one who possesses the most macabre interest in the world of the dead. But she can do things like hacking into police databases or organising getting the group clearing things to sites where some poor individual has died. Then we have one of the funniest members of the group, the Dowser, aka Namata. Before you ask, yes, dowsing relates to finding water veins in the ground, and no, water veins isn't what Namata uses his dowsing abilities for. Essentially being the archetypal tough guy of the bunch, Namata more often than not shows a more delicate side to his personality. Whether it be him becoming emotionally attached to his rotting customers, or whether it be him simply not being able to control his emotions when things go awry. Now, before we move on to my favourite character or characters, I'll first tell you about my least favourite, and that's Keiko Makino, who interestingly studied embalming in the US. For those of you that are unaware, embalming bodies isn't common in Japan. So she serves the purpose of at least being able to preserve the bodies a little bit longer if the rest of the crew need more time in completing the job. Though ultimately, that's all she really does. She's got a quirky personality in an alternative dress sense, but then in a group of mates who possess supernatural abilities, that doesn't really count for much, especially when you size her up to the following characters, which brings me on to my favourite of the bunch. Yuji Yata and Kara Ellis. Two characters, but also one and the same. Yata, the less interesting of the two, is simply the conduit by which the supposed super intelligent alien life form Kara Ellis is channeled through in the form of a felt hand puppet. That's right. Disrespectful, condescending, and full of foul-mouthed one-liners, Kara Ellis exhibits everything that you, as a reader, wouldn't like in a character, kind of like Scrappy-Doo minus the swearing. This nevertheless is what makes him, her, or it such a fun, likeable character, and it brings a whole new dimension to what is otherwise a potentially pretty depressing story, constantly pointing out mistakes and oversights that the inferior humans continually make. That's all I'm going to say about the characters, is I feel it's best to experience them firsthand and see how they all interact with one another, and this is after all the purpose of my review. Hosui Yamazaki delivers what you'd expect to see from the horror genre, a realistic, unapologetically grim artwork that at times makes you feel thankful that you can't actually smell the decaying flesh he so beautifully renders on a John and Jane Does. Though, on occasion, some of the characters go off-model when viewed from a profile shot, which can be a little bit disorientating. I for one think that it serves to accentuate the fragility of the human body and in turn life, but I'm doubtful that that was a committed effort on behalf of the artist, but, you know, each to their own. Yamazaki shares the same attention to detail that, say, Junji Ito has, though admittedly Yamazaki opts for a more believable approach in how the characters translate from pen to paper. Now, what I mean by that is when it's required for him to pen out something bizarre or abnormal, which accounts for the majority of the reading experience, whether it be parasitic snails bulging out of your eyeballs, or a person being able to determine others' time and location of death based on probability, he does it in a way that unnervingly makes you imagine yourself in the exact same situation. And what's terrifying about his art is its relatability and propensity to invoke within the reader a sense of, this could happen to me. Now, despite the black humour and the lurid narrative, the series actually touches upon some sensitive social issues, heavily focusing on the prevalent suicide culture in Japan today. I mean, the very first chapter is set in Aokigahara Forest, famed as a hotspot for young people to take their own lives in droves on an annual basis. It's scary, yes, but on different levels depending on how deeply you look into it. The way the story and characters communicate demonstrates the fragile balance established between fact and fiction, humorous and utterly pensive. The Kurosaki Corpse Delivery Service presents itself as a satirical social commentary on the taboos of suicide and at times political endeavour. It calls into question the history of Japan and how as a society the Japanese deal with death in such a way. It's quite upsetting when you consider that suicide is a universal sensitive spot, whereby people have different opinions and call into question any sort of morality surrounding it. Overall though, death is dealt with in this series in such a way to invoke within the reader a sense of understanding, not necessarily empathy, just acknowledgement. For alternative recommendations, I'd say pick up anything by Junji Ito, particularly Uzumaki or Fragments of Horror or Kyo. Or if you want something very similar, then by all means have a look into Mail, which is also written by Yamazaki himself. Now all that's left to say is I hope you find this review informative, and if you're interested in reading this series, know that now is a good time to do so, as it's currently being reprinted in omnibus editions by Dark Horse Manga. Thank you for watching, and stay safe, everyone.